In 1959, four major jazz albums were made that changed music forever. Miles Davis, Kinda Blue. Dave Brubeck's Time Out. Charles Mingus, Mingus Ahem. And Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come.
1959 was a very important jazz year for me and my own development and the evolution of jazz up until now and beyond.
It was a year that saw the biggest selling jazz album and single of all time.
Time Out was going where I envisioned jazz should go. I said, boy, this is fine. This is gonna work.
Jazz was pushed to new heights of innovation, beauty, and groove.
You know, the things would swing. Yeah, he'd lift you right out of your seat.
It was the end of the Eisenhower era, 2.5 children, and the white picket fence. In 1959, jazz is reaching white America in a big way.
Oh, why are they so sick and ridiculous? They brainwash and teach you, hey.
Jazz musicians didn't really, like, join the civil rights movement. The civil rights movement actually joined them.
And with Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come, 1959 saw the birth of a whole new free jazz movement.
When you talk about somebody speaking through their instrument, like actually hear it as a human, that's Ornette. He changed everything.
1959 was a phenomenon. It was on another level. That's all you can say.
Where are you going to work now?
Right here.
Okay, because if you move back, we don't get you.
When I play, though, I'm going to raise my horn a little bit.
Okay, just you four guys in this, right, Miles?
Five.
Ready?
Miles Davis, Kind of Blue, is the biggest selling jazz album ever made, shifting over 5 million copies. It regularly tops best jazz album polls, as well as featuring high in lists of the greatest albums of any category. Kind of Blue continues to convert more people to jazz than any other recording. All this 50 years after it was released.
Yeah.
And let's hear a little bit of it.
Right.
When they walked into the studio, they did not see this as their ultimate statement. They did not see this as the birth of a classic. It was a session that was scheduled for that day.
After Cannonball, you play again, and then we'll come in and end it.
They go over by the piano, and he's giving them instructions about the tunes we're going to play, you know. So, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of music. I didn't have any music at all. You know, just a piece of manuscript paper with some cards scribbled on it. Miles tells me, make this sound like it's floating.
Here we go. No title. Start again, please. Sorry. We gotta watch it because there's noises all the way through this. This is so quiet.
The first time I did it, the engineer said, the drums are making like a surface noise. So Miles hollered back at him and says, that's part of it.
Amazingly, Miles and his band spent a total of just 7 hours recording Kind of Blue. All but one of the tracks are first takes.
Anytime they completed a tune, that's what they were going to stick with. You know, it really is propelled by the idea that first thought is best thought.
Try it again, Irvin.
We would be hard-pressed to find any album opener that can compare to the opening of So What. This misty, unclear idea of where is the music going, where are we?
The intro for So What was totally improvised, had no time reference, no beat yet.
It's the piano and the bass sort of having this little conversation, and out of this musical cloud comes the riff, the grand riff, the one that says, so what? Boom-ba-doom-ba-doom-ba-doom-boom. And then just when the energy is sort of like getting to the point where it needs to be kicked up a notch, Jimmy Cobb comes in with this incredible cymbal crash.
When we got to the place where the solos were supposed to start, I hit the cymbal, and I thought I had overplayed it for the room. I thought I had hit it too hard.
But bang, it hits. You know, you can't plan on stuff like that happening. Miles' solo kicks off. So simple. Almost like a whispered confession, you know, by someone very intimate to you.
When Miles did Kind of Blue, it opened up a whole new direction in jazz, a more introspective, a new way of thinking about the creation of jazz and the creation of jazz compositions.
Part of Kind of Blue's enormous influence on music is the legacy of the band members. Many of them went on to become leaders in their own right, like saxophone virtuoso John Coltrane. But Kind of Blue is defined by Miles' incredibly hip trumpet sound.
He had this sound that was kind of like a haunting kind of voice. It was really individual, very unique, very special. The way he plays, sometimes it makes you feel life so deeply that you can almost cry, you know. And it didn't really sound like a trumpet anymore.
Trumpet technique on Kind of Blue was something he'd painstakingly developed since he first hit the scene in the late 1940s. Back then, the music had been changing.
In the 1940s, if you were a player, if you were an instrumentalist who was really starting to, you know, try and make the move, bebop was the music.
Bebop was a fast and frenetic style of jazz. It reflected jazz musicians' desire to be accepted as virtuoso artists, masters of their instruments. Bebop's greatest exponent was Charlie Parker.
Miles Davis is very precocious musical youngster. What he really wants to learn is bebop. And where he's going to learn it is on 52nd Street and up at Minton's, up in Harlem, playing with the bebop leader of that time, Charlie Parker.
Aged only 18, Miles became a member of Charlie Parker's band. As Miles traded solos with his hero, he was learning about bebop from the source.
Miles is not going to be a sideman for long. Miles, like many of the other musicians of that day, were trying to deal with the language of bebop. Where do we take bebop? Miles said, the music has become cluttered.
Part of his genius as a musician was that he edited what he heard Charlie Parker play. So if Charlie, for instance, used 10 notes to make a certain kind of a statement, Miles Davis might figure out how to use 3. Miles used what they call the harmonic bomb, that you hit this note that nobody expects to hit, and it has a greater power than just running up to the note another kind of a way.
There's a connective between these four artists, Charles Mingus, Dave Brubeck, Miles Davis, and Ornette Coleman, in that they're all dealing with bebop and the continuation of bebop. Where do we take this language? What do we do with it?
Another direction jazz took in 1959 was the rhythmic experimentation of pianist Dave Brubeck's Time Out. A highly unusual record, each track is in a different tempo and time signature. The single, Take Five, is in 5/4 time and built around a drum solo. Yet it rose up the pop charts, becoming the best-selling jazz 45 ever released. Brubeck had spent years building the lineup of his quartet that would go on to record Time Out.
I put together, gradually, this dream group. Because some bass players and some drummers didn't want to play in different time signatures, didn't want to follow where I went.
But Take Five drummer Joe Morello was originally unhappy coming into a band dominated by Brubeck and saxophonist Paul Desmond.
On a marquee, on any kind of a sign, it would say the Dave Brubeck Quartet featuring Paul Desmond, and the other guys were nothing. It could have been zilch, you know.
And I said, Joe, I'll feature you. So the first night he joined, I gave him a drum solo.
I did the drum solo in that place. Went wild and the people just stood up and clapped and all this nonsense. Paul Desmond, in the middle of the end of the solo, he just walks off the stand and runs in the dressing room.
And Paul said, either he goes or I go. And I said, Paul, he's not going.
Which was a shock, you know. He was a star in the group, not Dave, it was Paul. Well, he felt that way anyway. He didn't talk to me for about 5 months, you know.
the ending.
Did I play too many things for you?
I sat in the crossfire between these two wonderful players, keeping everything going and giving in or not giving in. And that quartet just started making real headway.
By the time they signed to Columbia Records in the mid-50s, the Dave Brubeck Quartet were one of America's top jazz bands.
His music was easily accessible to the average person. It was not too complicated. And the group was quite appealing because here you had four all-American young boys to watch as well as to listen to. Dave was quite easy to sell to Middle America because he looked like Middle America. He talked like Middle America. He was a nice guy that you're glad your daughter is going out with.
Brubeck's success widened. Parts of the jazz community accused him of being not only a sellout, but effectively a racist who diluted black music for mass consumption.
Jazz came out of black America. I mean, later, of course, white America catches up, and it always does. But there definitely was a resentment amongst black musicians regarding Dave Brubeck. In the 50s, the people who actually got successful from cool jazz were primarily white musicians.
See, he had broken into another audience that nobody really had. That's when people started getting mad at him. The thing about Dave is kind of strange for a guy who's light years away from a racist, right? Who's light years away from a commercial guy, who doesn't make recordings with any intention of pandering to the public, right? But the public likes him.
Brubeck himself was more concerned with fine-tuning the rhythm section of his quartet and tackling his ideas about where jazz should be headed.
And then Eugene Wright joined us, and finally, I had this dream group.
But the addition of bassist Eugene Wright didn't pass unnoticed when they toured universities in the southern states of America.
We were playing in a university, and they said, you can't go on stage with an African American. I said, well, then we're not going on stage. And then the students were stamping on the floor up above the dressing room. And the louder and wilder it got, the more concerned the president of the college was getting. So he told me, you can go on, but you have to put your bass player way in the back where there won't be too noticeable. When we walked on stage, the audience just went wild. They were so happy. The second tune, I told Eugene, your microphone's broke. Come out here and play your solo and use my speaker's mic in front of the band. Gene didn't know how I was plotting all this. He came out and we tore that place up. Oh, it was so wonderful. Yeah.
The classic lineup of the Dave Brubeck Quartet that would go on to record Time Out was now in place.
Thank you.
Bass player and composer Charles Mingus saw the question of how to take jazz forward in a different way. Mingus had risen through the ranks, playing in the bands of jazz legends like Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, and Charlie Parker. But for the notoriously opinionated and hot-tempered Mingus, jazz wasn't a calendar history of styles so much as an ever-present now.
Charles Mingus had a very strong sense that there was no past, there was no present, there was no future. All of the time was alive at the same moment. He was a great, great thinker about music. He didn't buy anything about that, you know, a style lasted from 1920 to 1930. Mingus didn't buy that. His thing was that if it was good then, it's good now. He wanted the freedom to play in, to write in, to encourage his musicians to know how to improvise in every style.
In 1959, Mingus recorded and released Mingus Ah-Um. It was one of four albums he made that year, not unusual in this prolific artist's long career. But Mingus Ah-Um was a tightly focused masterwork.
The title of the album sounds like a stutter before Wally's getting himself together to make his grand statement. Ah-Um? You know, what's that about? What's really, really devastating about Ah-Um is the consistency. Tune by tune by tune. I mean, it's Mingus at his best. Mingus was digging deep into that roots thing with that incredible opening track. Better Get It in Your Soul. It's like a gospel choir. It's like a Pentecostal performance on a Wednesday night prayer meeting. But the incredible magic of it is not just the influences. It's how Mingus works it all together and makes it into its own new thing.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, no applause and keep it down. Your drinks, don't rattle your ice in your glasses and don't ring the cash register. You got it covered? All right.
He had these enormous hands and that made it possible for him to do certain things technically that just other bass players couldn't do. In fact, he was one of the greatest bassists in jazz. Well, he was one of the greatest players of the bass, period.
I can hear him now. He was powerful. Powerful. You shut up when he played. Charlie Mingus was a big man with a big talent and a big temper. And people bugged him in the audience for some reason. Someone did. He got very angry, took his bass, and he smashed it through the light up there and broke it. The light's still there, the Mingus light. That's what it's become. Ripped the front door off once, and some little gal this big dragged it home, as I recall.
say a lot of musicians never played better in their life than when they played with Mingus, because he was so demanding, and he used everything. He used anger, he used insults, he used flattery, whatever he could use. He would fire musicians and hire them back, you know, 20 minutes later. Nothing was out of bounds.
He wanted you to understand his, play his music and be yourself in it. So often on a nightclub stand, he would stop and say to somebody, you're not playing yourself, you're playing notes.
I knew that Mingus was playing in this little club on West 4th Street, and I went into the club. There was an argument on the bandstand, they weren't even playing, and I heard Mingus like yelling at somebody, and it turned out to be the piano player. Mingus put his arm inside the piano, and he grabbed the strings and pulled them out with one fist. I said, man, it's time for me to get out of here. I never seen anything like that in my life.
Well, I'm gonna shoot it. A gun.
People are always telling me stories I don't want to hear about moments of Charles's volatility or things that took place, and in take place they did. And Charles created scenes. He was called Jazz's angry man, and he had plenty to be angry about. He had a lot to confront in those days for a man of his sensitivity and his sensibility and his talent, and unrecognized in many places merely because he had the wrong skin color. He wasn't dark enough and he wasn't light enough. He said, well, he called himself a mongrel or a mutt.
Like many jazz artists, Mingus was an extraordinary player and improviser. But with Mingus Ah-Um, he began to assume his position as one of jazz's greatest composers.
I love Self-Portrait in Three Colors, a little through-composed piece without any solos, just a little gem, beautiful, this multifaceted composition. Charles once said that he was, through his music, trying to express who he was. And he said the reason it was difficult is because he was changing all the time. But through his music, you hear the fear, you hear the spirituality, the tenderness, the passion. Everything that he was comes out in his music.
In 1959, Ornette Coleman made his spectacular musical statement in one quantum leap with the audaciously titled The Shape of Jazz to Come. But before he formed his quartet, Coleman, based in Los Angeles, had trouble finding anyone who was interested in his wildly unorthodox music.
Went over to this club by MacArthur Park on Wilshire called The Hague, and Jerry Mulligan was playing there. They started their first set, and after they began to play, a guy came in and asked if he could sit in. He got up on the bandstand and proceeded to take out his horn, and the horn was white. It was plastic, you know. I'd never seen a plastic horn before, you know. This guy started to play, it was like, you know, the heavens opened up for me because I saw and I heard something that I'd been feeling.
To me, they were playing as if the music was written. You know, when they was improvised, it was sounds like, oh, they've already learned that, you know. So I said, oh, I don't want to play like that. I want to play directly from something that inspired me. And they said, what are you doing? And I said, well, I'm improvising. So you ain't playing shit.
Kubek and saxophonist Paul Desmond.
On a marquee, on any kind of a sign, it would say, the Dave Brubeck Quartet featuring Paul Desmond. And the other guys were nothing. It could have been zilch, you know?
And I said, Joe, I'll feature you. So the first night he joined, I gave him a drum solo.
I did the drum solo, and the place went wild, and the people just stood up and clapped and all this nonsense. Paul Desmond, in the middle of the end of the solo, he just walks off the stand and runs in the dressing room.
And Paul said, either he goes or I go. And I said, Paul, he's not going.
Which was a shock, you know. He was a star in the group, not Dave, it was Paul. Well, he felt that way anyway. He didn't talk to me for about 5 months, you know.
Okay, now we got to work on the ending.
Did I play too many things for you?
I sat in the crossfire between these two wonderful players, keeping everything going and giving in or not giving in. That quartet just started making real headway.
By the time they signed to Columbia Records in the mid-50s, the Dave Brubeck Quartet were one of America's top jazz bands.
His music was easily accessible to the average person. It was not too complicated. And the group was quite appealing because here you had four all-American young boys to watch as well as to listen to. Dave was quite easy to sell to Middle America because he looked like Middle America. He talked like Middle America. He was a nice guy that you're glad your daughter is going out with.
Brubeck's success widened. Parts of the jazz community accused him of being not only a sellout, but effectively...
Like getting to the point where it needs to be kicked up a notch, Jimmy Cobb comes in with this incredible cymbal crash.
When we got to the place where the solos were supposed to start, I hit the cymbal, and I thought I had overplayed it for the room. I thought I had hit it too hard.
But bang, it hits. You know, you can't plan on stuff like that happening. Miles' solo kicks off. So simple. Almost like a whispered confession, you know, by someone very intimate to you.
Miles did Kind of Blue, it opened up a whole new direction in jazz, a more introspective, a new way of thinking about the creation of jazz and the creation of jazz compositions.
Part of Kind of Blue's enormous influence on music is the legacy of the band members. Many of them went on to become leaders in their own right, like saxophone virtuoso John Coltrane. But Kind of Blue is defined by Miles' incredibly hip trumpet sound.
He had this sound that was kind of like a haunting kind of voice. It was really individual, very unique, very special. The way he plays, sometimes it makes you feel life so deeply that you can almost cry, you know. And it didn't really sound like a trumpet anymore.
Miles' trumpet technique on Kind of Blue was something he'd painstakingly developed since he'd first hit the scene in the late 1940s. Back then, the music had been changing. Hot-tempered Mingus, jazz wasn't a calendar history of styles so much as an ever-present now.
Charles Mingus had a very strong sense that there was no past, there was no present, there was no future. All of the time was alive at the same moment. He was a great, great thinker about music. He didn't buy anything about that, you know, a style lasted from 1920 to 1930. Mingus didn't buy that. His thing was that if it was good then, it's good now. He wanted the freedom to play in, to write in, to encourage his musicians to know how to improvise in every style.
In 1959, Mingus recorded and released Mingus Ah-Um. It was one of four albums he made that year, not unusual in this prolific artist's long career. But Mingus Ah-Um was a tightly focused masterwork.
The title of the album sounds like a stutter before Wally's getting himself together to make his grand statement. You know, what's that about? What's really, really devastating about is the consistency. Tune by tune by tune. I mean, it's Mingus at his best. Mingus was digging deep into that roots thing with that incredible opening track. Better Get It in Your Soul. It's like a gospel choir. It's like a Pentecostal performance on a Wednesday night prayer meeting. But the incredible magic of it is not just the influences. It's how Mingus works it all together and makes it into its own new thing.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, no applause and keep it down. Your drinks, no rather your ice in your glasses and...
A little cymbal crash.
When we got to the place where the solos were supposed to start, I hit the cymbal and I thought I had overplayed it for the room. I thought I had hit it too hard.
But bang, it hits. You know, you can't plan on stuff like that happening. Miles' solo kicks off, so simple, almost like a whispered confession, you know, by someone very intimate to you. Thank you.
Miles did Kind of Blue, it opened up a whole new direction in jazz, a more introspective, a new way of thinking about the creation of jazz and the creation of jazz compositions.
Part of Kind of Blue's enormous influence on music is the legacy of the band members. Many of them went on to become leaders in their own right, like saxophone virtuoso John Coltrane. But Kind of Blue is defined by Miles' incredibly hip trumpet sound.
He had this sound that was kind of like a haunting kind of voice. It was really individual, very unique, very special. The way he plays, sometimes it makes you feel life so deeply that you can almost cry, you know. And it didn't really sound like a trumpet anymore.
Miles' trumpet technique on Kind of Blue was something he'd painstakingly developed since he first hit the scene in the late 1940s. Back then, the music had been changing.
In the 1940s...
See, he was a star in the group, not Dave, it was Paul. Well, he felt that way anyway. He didn't talk to me for about 5 months, you know.
Did I play too many things for you then?
I sat in the crossfire between these two wonderful players, keeping everything going and giving in or not giving in. And that quartet just started making real headway.
They signed to Columbia Records in the mid-50s. The Dave Brubeck Quartet were one of America's top jazz bands.
His music was easily accessible to the average person. It was not too complicated, and the group was quite appealing because here you had four all-American young boys to watch as well as to listen to. Dave was quite easy to sell to Middle America because he looked like Middle America. He talked like Middle America. He was a nice guy that you're glad your daughter is going out with.
Brubeck's success widened. Parts of the jazz community accused him of being not only a sellout, but effectively a racist who diluted black music for mass consumption.
Jazz came out of black America. I mean, later, of course, white America catches up, and it always does. But there definitely was a resentment amongst black musicians regarding Dave Brubeck. In the 50s, the people who actually got successful from cool jazz were primarily white musicians.
See, he had broken into another audience that nobody really had. That's when people started getting mad at him. The thing about Dave is kind of strange for a guy who's light years away from a racist, right? Who's light years away from a commercial guy, who doesn't make recordings with any intention of pandering to the public, right? But the public likes him. impossible for him to do certain things technically that just other bass players couldn't do. In fact, he was one of the greatest bassists in jazz. Well, he was one of the greatest players of the bass, period.
I can hear him now. He was powerful. Powerful. You shut up when he played. Charlie Mingus was a big man with a big talent and a big temper. And people bugged him in the audience for some reason. Someone did. He got very angry, took his bass, and he smashed it through the light up there and broke it. The light's still there, the Mingus light. That's what it's become. He ripped the front door off once, and some little gal this big dragged it home, as I recall.
They say a lot of musicians never played better in their life than when they played with Mingus, because he was so demanding, and he used everything. He used anger, he used insults, he used flattery, whatever he could use. He would fire musicians and hire them back, you know, 20 minutes later. Nothing was out of bounds.
He wanted you to understand his play, his music, and be yourself in it. So often on a nightclub stand, he would stop and say to somebody, you're not playing yourself, you're playing notes.
I knew that Mingus was playing in this little club on West 4th Street, and I went into the club. There was an argument on the bandstand, they weren't even playing, and I heard Mingus like yelling at somebody, and it turned out to be the piano player. Mingus put his arm inside the piano, and he grabbed the strings and pulled them out with one fist. I said, man, it's time for me to get out of here. I never seen anything like that in my life.
Well, I'm gonna shoot it. A gun.
People are always telling me stories I don't want to hear about moments of Charles's volatility or things that took place, and take place they did. And Charles created scenes. He was called Jazz's Angry Man, and he had plenty to be angry about. He had a lot to confront in those days for a man of his sensitivity and his sensibility and his talent, and unrecognized in many places, merely because
that the audience just went wild. They were so happy. The second tune, I told Eugene, your microphone's broke. Come out here and play your solo and use my speaker's mic in front of the band. Gene didn't know how I was plotting all this. He came out and we tore that place up. Oh, it was so wonderful. Yeah.
The classic lineup of the Dave Brubeck Quartet that would go on to record Time Out was now in place. Bass player and composer Charles Mingus saw the question of how to take jazz forward in a different way. Mingus had risen through the ranks, playing in the bands of jazz legends like Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, and Charlie Parker. But for the notoriously opinionated and hot-tempered Mingus, jazz wasn't a calendar history of styles so much as an ever-present now.
Charles Mingus had a very strong sense that there was no past, there was no present, there was no future. All of the time was alive at the same moment.
It
Crosby was a great, great thinker about music. He didn't buy anything about that, you know, a style lasted from 1920 to 1930. Mingus didn't buy that. His thing was that if it was good then, it's good now. He wanted the freedom to play in, to write in, to encourage his musicians to know how to improvise in every style.
In 1959, Mingus recorded and released Mingus Ah-Um. It was one of four albums he made that year, not unusual in this prolific artist's long career. But Mingus Ah-Um was a tightly focused masterwork.